Okay, welcome to the fourth and final part of this little footsteps tutorial. And we're going to do a little bit of scripting now. If you remember where we left off, we essentially have this very simple scene with a first-person controller walking around on two different materials. And in the third part, we created two collider regions that changed the sound depending on a switch, an audio kinetic switch. Now we are not going to do that differently, and I'm going to do one thing. I'm going to delete that. And the idea is that instead of changing the regions, we would like to give the individual surfaces their own sound material. So in addition to having a regular material, and a visual material, so to speak, we are also going to give them a sound material. Now, the way this is implemented is also exactly the way Audio Kinetic did it in the Wise Adventure game. So if you went through, or if you're going through the certification, the Unity Wise Integration Certification, that's Wise 301. What we're going to do now is exactly the way it is implemented there. But what I did is I essentially just extracted the main parts and essentially kind of made it much simpler, because in the obviously the Wise Adventure game is a very complex game already. So there's a lot of thought that went into that, and there are many things that designers took care of, and we're going to just kind of look at the bare bones implementation and how that would work. Now, the general idea is very simple. What we're going to do is we're going to give the surfaces their own sound material, and then we're going to create a little script that we're going to attach to the first-person controller that essentially checks what object is underneath the first-person controller, and if that object has a sound material attached to it, and if it has, what that sound material is, and then depending on that switches the sound accordingly. That has a couple of advantages and disadvantages. The advantage is that we don't rely on entering and exiting colliders, so essentially each footstep should create the correct sound. The disadvantage is it's computationally slightly more expensive. So especially when you have a large game, we need to think about optimizing everything accordingly. And also there are a lot more calls of the switch essentially in Wise. So we are going to see that when we do that, we are going to call the switch every time we take a footstep, whereas in the implementation we had in part three, the switch was only called when we entered a trigger collider. So how are we going to do that? Well, once again, idea is very simple. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to add a sound material to the surface types. So I'm just going to add a component here, and I'm going to just do a new script, and let's call that sound material. And I'm using that terminology, which, because it's exactly the terminology we'll also find in the Wise Adventure game. So now it takes a little until the whole thing updates. And that sound material is really only a container. All it really does, it holds a switch object. And that switch object is really the sound material. The switch object sort of is the part that tells Wise what material we're working on. Okay, here we have the sound material. So let's open that. And we actually don't need any of that. So let's just get rid of everything. And the only thing we really need is we're going to have it keep an object of the type switch. So let's ak.wise.switch. And let's call it material. And we want to be able to access that from the outside. So essentially what we need is we need to make that public so that we can access that. Let's just for measure do it. Okay. File save. So now it should update. Once again, it will take a second. Okay, we are. So the material is now visible. And once again, the script itself doesn't really do anything. It just holds that switch. That's all it does. Now we are on, this is sort of the concrete part. So what we're going to do is we're going to drop the concrete switch on our sound material script. And then we need to do the same thing with the dirt. So let's just add a component. Now we already have that sound material. And let's add the dirt and put that in here. Okay, so we have the concrete and dirt. So now the materials sort of know what how this should sound. So we now need to tell the first person controller with before it plays the footstep sound what switch or what material we're actually working on. Now, if you look through the Vice Adventure game the way they did in the Vice Adventure game, because it's a third person view, essentially they created a little material checker script that they attached to the toes really of the third person character, and it then essentially had a very complex way of actually kind of getting access to that material underneath those toes. Now, because we are dealing with a first person controller, things are slightly simpler. So all we really need to do is, if we go back to the part of the script where we play the footstep audio, before we actually play the footstep, before we call the event or post the event, we need to see or we need to change the switch according to the material that's underneath. So how do we find out what is underneath? And the trick is always the same. We are going to cast array and see what object is hit by that array. So in order to do that, let's get right to it. So we are going to call the physics engine, right? And we are going to cast array. Raycast. Right. The first thing in this raycast algorithm, we need to tell the system from what point we are casting the ray. And the point really is the position of the first person controller. So we are going to take the game object, which is the first person controller. We are going to look at the transform node, which tells the location. And out of this transform node, we're going to do the position. Right. So this is sort of the position where I'm at right now. We want to see what's underneath me. So the direction in which the ray is cast is vector 3 dot down. Right. And then essentially we need to get the object that is hit back. In order to be able to do that, essentially I need to create a reference. So I need to pass on a reference to a hit object, and that hit object is, I just closed that, is an ray cast hit. Right. So we have this ray cast hit that is the reference to that hit is passed on to the physics engine, which casts the ray from the location of the player downwards. And because this is a reference to the object, essentially when this function is completed, it will actually return a reference to the object. Okay, so now we have the object. Now we need to get the sound material of that object. So we want to create, or we not want to find the sound material. Let's call it SM. And that sound material is a component of the object that is hit, right? So we want of the hit. We want to know what collider we have hit. The collider sits in an object, so we need access to that object. And in that object, we need to find the component of the sound material. So we need to kind of a get component. And we want a particular component. So we are going to, oopsie, good component. And it should be a sound material component. Okay. So this should return the sound material of that component. And then in the final step, we need to set the value in that sound component. So we're going to call sm.set. Just double check. I'm not doing anything incorrectly here. The material node, we need to reference the material node dot set value. And that set value, once again, we are in a, the switch is relative to an object. So we need to tell in with respect to what object that value has to be set. Now that script is in the first person controller object, and the first person controller is also the listener. So we need to set it with respect to that object. So game object. Okay. Now this is technically everything we need to do. There are just a couple of things we need to do in order to make sure that nothing goes wrong. Let's say I'm floating around and there's no material underneath me, or I have layer mask set up and the ray is not hitting anything, or I forgot to add the sound material and I'm hitting something, but that doesn't include the sound material. We want to make sure that there are no errors thrown. So we just need to make a couple of checks that everything is okay. So the first thing that can happen is that essentially nothing is hit. So I just need to make sure that the physical internet is actually hitting something. Right. So if nothing is hit, the physics, the raycast algorithm returns a false value. So only if I actually have a hit, then I should do something. Then I'm checking for the sound material. Now it could be that there is no component in there, so I just need to make sure that I'm only calling that if there's actually a component in there. So so if that is not null, then. Set that value. Okay, and that's essentially everything I need to do. So this should work now. So essentially, I'm casting a ray from the first person controller downwards. I'm getting the object that is hit. I'm looking at the collider of the object that is hit, taking the game object in which this collider is in, getting the component that is a sound material, the first one. So if I have multiple ones, and it's getting me the first one. I'm checking if that is actually existing. So if I actually have a sound material, and if it exists, I set the value. So I essentially set the switch with respect to the game object, which is the first person controller. Okay, so it's actually a fairly simple script, but there's a lot of stuff going on in here. So let me just wait until Unity has. Updated and compiled everything. Okie dokie. So let's see. Let's see if that works. the moment of truth. Concrete. Dirt. Concrete. Dirt. And just to make sure, let's just start a profiling session. Boy. Ah, here we are. Okay. Now the advantage now obviously is that as I'm essentially checking whenever I'm walking, I'm checking exactly what surface is underneath me. That means that I'm always getting the correct, as long as I have a sound material attached to the surface that I'm walking on, I'm always getting the correct sound. But obviously, if you look into Vice, essentially what is happening now is that I'm having a lot more calls to the switch than I had before, simply because I'm now calling the switch whenever I'm taking a step, really. Okay, that was pretty much it. So essentially two different ways to do footsteps. I'm pretty sure there are like a million different ways in addition to that, but those are probably the two that are most interesting. The first one, once again, with the trigger colliders would be one that you would primarily implement when you already have a fairly completed game and you need to add the footsteps later on. The second one is a little bit more elegant in that it is more, it wouldn't necessarily say secure, but it's more reliable. As long as you make sure that all the materials have a sound material on there, you can be sure that you're always getting the correct sound. But it's computationally a little bit more expensive, especially if you have a larger game with lots of objects. You need to make sure that the recasting algorithm is efficient. So so you would introduce layer mask and make sure that essentially it's not checking every object, every possible object in the game for intersections. That would be not advisable, but it is a much nicer implementation. Okay, that was pretty much it. I might post a couple of additional tutorials. Once again, this tutorial was primarily that came out of a game audio class that I was teaching, and I found that there's very little information about the integration online. People talk about it. There are a couple of YouTube videos. If the Audio Kinetic site has a couple of videos as well, but kind of I've rarely seen something that's really kind of where it really is focused on one particular thing only and kind of really a bare bones kind of thing, so that makes clear what is it exactly that I need to do if I want to complete a certain particular task. And a couple of other things that I find that our students sometimes are asking and kind of would be interested in, so I might actually kind of add a couple of those tutorials, provided that I have the time to do that. Otherwise, thank you for watching, and I hope you enjoy the Vice Unity integration. Thank you.